back in the early days of HIV, diagnosis and treatment, there was no blood test to see who had the antibodies against HIV, and there was no blood test to measure the amount of virus particles. In fact, it wasn't until 1983 that the virus that causes AIDS was isolated in France. In early 84, it was isolated in the US as well. So along the very beginnings, there were simply a matter of saying really ill people with unusually destroyed immune systems for no other reason were called AIDS patients. Of course, it was early on called gay-related immune deficiency and some other acronyms. But still, the point is that the first people had pneumocystis carinii pneumonia and Kaposi's sarcoma. The thing they had in common, these were urban, mostly white, homosexual men who otherwise should not have had destroyed immune systems. Pneumocystis carinii pneumonia was known to occur in infants who were starved in World War II type orphanages. It occurred in people whose immune system was destroyed by steroids and other drugs for treating leukemia and cancer. Kaposi's sarcoma existed in some form in Mediterranean elderly men and in younger Bantu men in Africa, but not in white urban men in their 20s. Yet those are the two illnesses that were first discovered, and putting them together, epidemiologists figured that they had to have a sexual transmission link. Initially then, if a young person had pneumocystis carinii pneumonia and had no other reason for that, that is, they were not taking cancer chemotherapy drugs, they would be called an AIDS patient. If they had Kaposi's sarcoma, they would be called an AIDS patient. The definition expanded. If they had unusual fungus infections with no other reason to have it, they would be called an AIDS patient. Later, when we had more testing available, we would look at the immune cell count. And it was decided that a CD4 count of 200 or less was an AIDS diagnosis. Partly that was chosen because most of the people with pneumocystis carinii pneumonia and HIV had CD4 counts less than 200. So if they didn't yet have that pneumonia, it was assumed that they would soon fall victim to that and they should be protected. So the AIDS versus just having HIV diagnosis came about partly over time based on case definition and laboratory data. Again, before the blood test was available for the population, which was March of 1985, people were waiting and waiting and waiting. There's a saying in English about waiting for the other shoe to drop. They knew they were a man who had sex with men. They knew they were ill. They had a little anemia. Their lymph nodes had been swollen. They might have had a little infection in their mouth or some other skin problems, for example, a little diarrhea. But they didn't have pneumocystis carinii pneumonia. They didn't have Kaposi's sarcoma. So they really weren't called a full-blown AIDS patient. They were just sort of pre-AIDS, as one way of putting it. So over the years, that's been the difference. Right now, what we do is we say it's either HIV, you have it, or you don't. If you have HIV, then it's simply a question of where along the continuum, where along the spectrum are you? Are you severely depleted in your immune cells, or only moderately or mildly depleted in your immune cells? Are you ill from something because you have HIV? Has, for example, tuberculosis flared up because you have HIV? Have you had other infections? So it's really a matter of looking at things a little differently, and so the terminology has changed. But basically, if a person has HIV, We want to know where do they stand right now in terms of their immune system, and as using that, we'll develop a medication program that's appropriate for them.